Next up is Fam, Fabiola, and De La Cueva, and of her own Delacour, and she will be talking to us about focusing on technical wealth, which I believe is the converse of technical debt. So we're gonna have a interactive part during the presentation. So did everybody get the post-its, the color-coded post-its? No? Okay, so after I put the mic down, I will get them to anybody that doesn't have them.
And then there's time to get them.
Okay. There's like 30 seconds, and then we have to use them, right?
No.
Okay. So I think without further ado, let's get started.
I've heard that people come back just because I'm entertaining, so I'm okay with that answer. Just a couple of questions. Was anything on the topic or on the description that made you say I'm going to come to this presentation?
Because it's you.
Money. Yeah, money. Can I become rich finally doing this software thing, right? Any other ideas? I just want to make sure, you tell me you're here for the entertainment, I can tell you can stay. If you tell me that you're here for something else and I realize that I'm not 100% that, I can tell you can go to another
place. We're here for money.
Yeah, but I've heard that. So, yeah, it's not that kind of wealth. So, hopefully you do get to say some of that. All right. So, the goal of this presentation is I want you to stop accruing technical debt. Okay? Instead, I want you to look at the little guy there that he's carrying the debt there. I want you to break free with technical wealth, okay? I want you to keep this image. The whole idea of this presentation is I'm going to be showing you some case studies that I have learned in the 11 years that I've worked at Delacour. And all of those case studies are composites of several of my customers. And I try to give you the options of the thing that we did and the thing, and which one worked for us, but I'm gonna have you guess which one worked better.
Hey,
Pat. Yes?
I think it'd be better with the mic.
Right.
If you don't mind.
Well, I asked at the beginning, and they said they could hear me back there. Is it better?
They couldn't hear you. They couldn't hear you when you asked.
So you really want me with the mic?
I think it'd be better.
Okay. But it's off. See? You said that it would be better, but I think.
No.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing, is when I was at the keynote yesterday, the hardest thing was to keep hearing my voice. I don't like my voice. Alright. So summary. So sorry, for those of you that thought that you were here for the get rich quick, you can leave now. I won't be offended. It's not one of those things. What I'm going to be giving you is tips on accruing and creating technical assets. And I owe Mr. Steve Watts that terminology once we were brainstorming about these things. What I want for you to think about is when we get too busy and when somebody comes with a good idea, you say, yeah, that sounds like, but I'm too busy, I'm not going to try it. I don't want you to try every single thing that I'm telling you, but pick one. And then analyze later on if it really gave you the return on investment. And then if it did, you keep it. If not, you throw it. And then you try another one. The whole idea is to build technical wealth so when you have those situations where you normally accrue technical debt, you have a bank account where you can take a loan because you already have that technical wealth that you have been putting together. That make sense? Okay? Increasing your technical wealth leads to increased confidence in your software. If the technical assets, which I'm going to tell you which ones are there, these will be the technical dividends. This is the interest. This is what you get, and then you get to pay off and, you know, inherit it even to your team members or whoever's going to come after you. All right. I'm not going to claim all credit. It was the background, I was inspired by an article that I read from Andrea Brunet from Portibytes. And if you Google technical wealth, her article is like the first or second. So I recommend, if you're interested in all these software engineering processes things, that you read it. She obviously works on text-based programming and talks a lot about legacy code. What is legacy code? Is that code that is not documented, that you need to repurpose in order to make it useful for the new product? And one of the things that she mentions is that it takes a certain personality to want to work with that type of code. Most of software developers want to work on the new exciting thing. They don't want to do software maintenance. The problem with that is like 80% of what you're doing is software maintenance, right? So it's an interesting article. She touches a lot of more points than I am going to do. So I recommend reading it. And there are some other talks that she has done. And she also has a podcast. And there's also your own Slack. She has a channel too that's called Legacy Code Rocks, and there's a blog post about it. Some of the things apply to us, some doesn't. Okay, so she got me thinking on architects. We are software architects, so comparing software architecture to actually being an architect for a house. So I was thinking, okay, an architect, what do they do? So you might have an architect that does landscaping. You might have an architect that does small buildings, one that does large buildings, and maybe one that specializes on getting those old houses from 200-300 years ago and remodeling them, right? Does that mean that I cannot hire an architect that knows how to build a small building to do a remodel? You probably will know, you will have the same tools, but he might not be as good at it. Make sense? Everybody on the same page? Okay. So I think this applies to software architects as well. I think we have different software architecture specialties, and we have different types of applications. Some of those are going to be small applications. It's going to be like what Brian Powell was showing earlier. I just want to do acquire and analyze percent. That's it. There might be medium to large applications where you're having to connect to a database and do reports and send information to processes, or like we were talking with Casey yesterday, hundreds of processes running in parallel. Or you get called, like I get called a lot, to come put out fires of somebody that wrote a code 10, 15 years ago, and it worked, and all of a sudden it stops working overnight, right? And you start going into the debugging, and that's a totally different type of architecture. So, which type of architect are you guys? So let's see, raise your hand if you're an architect or a software engineer that works mainly on small applications. Okay, how many of you do large applications? Right. And how many of you are stuck with the remodeling and renovating? Okay. Everybody, all right. How many of you like to work on existing code? Enjoy working on this.
I'm saving the thing.
So this is one of the things that Andrea says, right? I actually enjoy taking that spaghetti code, and I have a customer that called his code the China cabinet, because I move things around and the wires start breaking and everything starts falling apart and I don't know what I did. I only moved a wire and that was enough for everything to come down. But I actually enjoy the challenge of making that into something that's going to be modular and going to be more efficient, and it reduces the cost. So it does take a certain kind of personality. All right, so technical debt. I looked over the web for several definitions, and I really didn't like what I was reading, so got the team at Delacorp and we started brainstorming how we define technical debt. And we decided that the definition is suboptimal design decisions based on extenuating circumstances. We felt that that was the most generic way to express all the corner cutting that people do. Now, you know how I like my maxims and be very like, this is the way it is. There are four things that determine the success of your project. Quality, scope, time, budget, and resources. And as far as I'm concerned, and I know Dimitri's gonna say that the startups can actually clutch on that one, I never caught on the quality one. I caught on scope, or on time, or on budget, or I encourage my customers to do that. The reason for that is that even though I enjoy the challenge of restructuring old code and getting it to work nicely, I don't like to go and do that for the code that I wrote or one of my team members wrote. I don't like to go back and redo my work because we cut a corner. So that's my personal opinion, is that quality should not budge. If you are getting tempted to do that, you're going to pay with interest down the road. Another thing I'd recommend is Google Inception Deck. This is a term for some of the agile teams, and it's part of a book called the Agile Summary. I think it's the Agile Summary or the Agile Order. Has anybody read it?
The ladder.
What was that?
Samurai?
Yeah, it's a samurai. Yeah, the Agile Summary. So the Inception Deck is a very good exercise. It's meant more for like a startup. And I know that some of you that work on test and measurement or something that's a lot drier, you're not going to feel like you need to do it. Because it has to do something like define what your product would look like if you were going to put it in a grocery store. Define what would be the slogan that you would put to get people to buy it. And all of that is part of getting you to think about what is it that as a team we're building. And one of the things that it suggests is do not just look at your stakeholders. Typical thing. How many of you have had issues with the IT department? Okay. When do you involve the IT department on your project? When there's a problem.
Never
at the beginning, right? Never. You never think about going down to the basement and going, guys, I'm going to go have lunch. I just want to kind of like learn. Whatever. But it's really interesting. It makes you think about going a little bit out of your circle and figuring those things out early on. Okay? So, thoroughly recommend, if nothing else, read the thing and keep what you want. Alright, so if technical debt was the collection of optimal design decisions based on extenuating circumstances, then the technical wealth is the collection of technical assets that eliminates or reduces the suboptimal design decisions. Basically, because you have done this investment, not only do you know how to address when you are exposed to these problems, but you are also avoiding even getting in the first place to those problems. So some of the things that a developer we define as technical assets: project templates, wizards, reusable libraries, API testers if you're using DQMH, software development process elements like continuous integration or system development lifecycle, having a unit testing policy, some of the software quality tools, the analyzer, custom tests, having a style guidelines. This is what we see as technical assets. Does anybody have suggestions of any other that I'm not listing here? What was that? Yeah, code review guidelines. Yeah, and actually another one has. Yeah. Code review process and guidelines. Anyone else? Using version control, yeah. Having a policy, and this is, you know, given that I all give so many times such a hard time to everyone, I should be ashamed of myself if that is not. Yeah, version control.
Good API design.
API design, yeah, and having some, if not rules, guidelines as to how do we as a team define the API of our libraries, yes.
Internal training tools.
Internal training tools, yeah, onboarding. This is something that we do at Delacorp, and I've had the feedback of everyone that has gone through it, that they don't expect such a small company to do this. We have an onboarding letter, and we make it a welcome. You know, this is why you're coming on board, highlighting all the qualities, and then a list of tasks or what you need to do to be ready to work with us. And that's that, you know, going through some videos for training, setting up certain things on your computer. So that's something that becomes actually a technical asset, because when people start working on your projects, they don't have to guess how is it that you expect them to work with you. What was that? Virtual machine server. Having a strategy for managing your virtual machines. How many of you use virtual machines? All right. How many don't use virtual machines? All right. I would like to hear why are you using VPNs? Just curious. What was that? Yeah, no, that's true. He works at a very large company, so he just goes and calls. We just need 5 more VPNs. So yeah, same here. Yeah. Any of the other guys that raised their hand actually work for a small company where money is actually the issue and they cannot just go for more computers? No? So I guess it's a valid reason, I guess. We like the virtual machines because you can do snapshots. So you can set up your machine to be a clean, fresh installation of whatever you're testing. And then you deploy your executable, you start messing with it and make it totally go out of rate, the property is a problem, and then you go back to snapshot, and you have again a quick computer to start. And it makes the process really fast. It's faster than having the I just recommend just maybe take it. Okay, so time is up. Wake up if you were taking a siesta while I was talking. So here's the deal. There's 3 post-its. Bing is option A. B is option green is option B. And then there's this blue one. I love for people to participate in my presentation, and I start to feel like nobody's listening when they don't participate, and I might get a little aggressive, you would say. So I decided that I was going to give you a way out. So if you don't want me to harass you because you're not participating, you can put the blue post it on your forehead, raise it, whatever you want, and I won't harass you. Promise. Okay? So that's why I added the blue one. So you can tell your friends it's okay to go to class presentations. She's not going to eat you alive if you have the blue post it. All right. Everybody understands? Yeah? Everybody has one? All right. Okay. So we're going to start going from smaller to larger. We're going to start with the demo. So this is the team, it's a small team, they have to create a demo for an investor's meeting. This is when I get to work with startups, very energetic team. They're always a start with the idea that they have 6 months and end up only having 2 weeks to implement everything. So they're always in a hurry. The demonstration involves hardware and software. There is an existing version of the code that works. To their credit, I mean, they say that it's solid. But you know when you start probing that it actually works 97% of the time. Okay? There are a few failures here and there. And they want to add some features. You have very limited time, like I said, they thought at the beginning they had 6 months, and now it turns out that they just have 2 weeks. Where would you invest your time in the first days of the project? Fix a problem, okay. Demand to my own thinking.
Understand the requirements.
Understand the requirements, okay?
Identify the problems.
Identify the problems. Alright. So, those are good words. So we went directly to fixing them. We said over there, let's identify them first. And the other one was, let's figure out what are the requirements and what are the new features.
Let's get it working so it satisfies the investors.
Let's get it working so it satisfies. Okay, so we're getting in a good thing. So now let me tell you a little bit about the existing code. Okay? The code that's solid, that works. Nice and gentlemen. Okay. The error out from the variant to data is not wired. When I asked the developer, why didn't you wire the error? Because this was a template, so he actually went to the process of removing the error wire. The answer was, it was giving me an error. I didn't have time to troubleshoot, so I removed it. There's a loop trying to send a message multiple now we start to have an admission that there was a problem and that they have an idea where the problem was. The way they fix it was by putting it forward. Nobody here has done that, right? No? I haven't. There are blocks of code identified as belonging to the previous version of the project. The way I know they are from the previous version of the project, let's say that the new project is called Brown and the old project was called Green, and you actually see the green initiator, the green in several places, and it no longer, the wording no longer fits with the new project. But they were trying to reuse, so they copy the same VIs and they check the same names. Alright. They are using DQMH, but the testers are broken, and not all the public API events are being exercised. So this is a typical thing with DQMH. How many here use DQMH? Alright. Are you using your testers? Okay. I said I was going to be good. Alright. So, come to a session tomorrow. I don't remember when the room is. I should know it at the end. I convinced Darren to do a coding live thing challenge where he's going to write an application from 0 to 100 using DQMH. And it's either going to be great or going to be a big flop, but it's going to be entertaining, for sure. And he's going to show you why you want to have the API testers. Alright, so I already told you kind of like the situation and the code we're dealing with. So, you're going to raise pink if you are going to focus your time on writing the requirements, building the executable after each new feature is added, and then test with the full system. Or you're going to go with green, clean up code, get API testers working, build API, and then you're going to start building initially your testers until you're ready to build your executable. And again, you have the way out. And you have 2 weeks for the investment. All right. So let's see. Wow. Either I kind of biased you, or the CLAs, like even at KBC in the business presentation, they were a lot more divided. Okay, I see a couple of pinks. Who wants to say why?
Here's a thought. I feel like every demo that starts and asks for the demo later turns into, oh, that was great, can we get that demo? And
yeah, the proof of concept becomes the heart of the application. Yeah, I've had those. Yes. Anyone else?
So I kind of feel like I was going to write requirements on the train and so the reason I would say why I said before, analyze or understand the requirements is because I want to make sure that I'm only doing what I need to do.
So,
I'm not going to do anything extra.
Yeah, and that's great if you're starting with work to solve, right? The issue here is they say it's solid. Their next round of funding depends on the software performing flawlessly in front of the investors. Do you come and become part of the problem and add more features? Or you try to make it solid so they get the second round of funding? I've done both. My team has done both. We have been dragged into, no, we need to add a really the next feature, the investors really want to see it. And we have been able to also to convince our customers and being like, no, I think the investors, I don't know, appreciate that the last time what they saw that was not solid, right now it's proven, and you can actually show them that you have all these things to prove that you solved it. That it was not, I thought by putting it in a loop of 3 times, it was going to solve it. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm like going back to his point though, what if the flaws are in things that aren't required? Then that's a basis to go back, look and see what's required.
That's a good point. One of the things, it's funny because we're going to the complete extreme from what Becky was presenting, right? Becky was presenting large systems, tons of money up front. We're talking here about all you have is software. Yes, there's some hardware, but it's already bought.
Yeah, but I'm not saying write new requirements. I'm saying understand what the software is supposed to do.
Yes. They're calling us to help, but yeah, we're familiar with the project. We're familiar with it.
Oh, okay.
investors and startup companies, it's best to have the software fully solid and working, and you explain to the investors that it's not finished and the features are not there yet, than to have all the features and then it crops out the mini demo.
Yeah, that's what he's saying. The worst thing that you can do as a startup is going into a demo that has all the features, all the bells and whistles, and then it crops in the middle of the demonstration. So investors are going to be okay with a wireframe. They're going to be okay with a UI not looking perfect. Especially if you tell them that you are crossing all your T's and putting all your dots in your eyes. So the purpose of these exercises, again, I don't think there's a right or wrong answer. And this is a role play. You know, we don't have all the variables in place. It's just thinking the next time that you're going with whatever is your training or what you used to do, just take a step back and think, is this really the only avenue that I have? And am I actually, by following process and writing requirements and making sure that I have a very clear idea of what we're doing, actually accruing the technical depth? Because what I'm doing when I'm writing those requirements is I'm losing time, right? Because I only have 2 weeks. Now you need to be aware that you are, when you decide to not do that and go directly to cleaning the code, you also accruing technical debt. The question is, which one is the one that's going to make me pay more interest later? Okay? And I tend to go more for having a solid foundation. Because if there's something wrong with the window, I'll replace the window. But if the window starts cracking because the foundation is wrong and I have to redo the foundation to the house, that's a big payment later, right? All right, the original equipment manufacturer guy. This is someone that might have some hardware from NI inside their box. They might have an embedded computer there running software, and they sell out a nice box to the customer. The customer just turns it on, and it does dances, sings, whatever it's supposed to be doing, okay? The product has been in the market for over 10 years. There's no documentation. It is the epitome of a spaghetti code. There's limited source code control. They do use Subversion. But when you go and check how they're using it, the names of the VIs have the version number, and the project changes name every time they change the version number. So they're really using it as a backup system.
Okay. We must have had the same customer.
Yeah, we must have had the same customer, yeah. Like I said, it's a composite of several customers, so. Yeah. In the past, you have been called to help troubleshoot two major episodes on the history of the product. These two times that you were called, they were about to lose the business because they needed, you know, the end customer was losing millions of dollars because the equipment is used in a manufacturing place, and they're begging you to come and they don't mind paying extra, and you're like, okay. You have identified in all these interactions process improvements, alternatives to the architecture that would get the job done and replace. Oh yeah, I forgot. It's the VI. The whole application is a single VI. And if you put it on the navigation window, it goes maybe 50 by 50. But it works. I mean, the guy has been in business more than 10 years, right? It does the work. Okay. The customer only wants you to add one more feature. Just this time. Just once more, Fabiola. I promise, once we solve this issue, we'll go and be good boys and implement all the stuff that you want us to implement. Okay? All right. Hey, you implement the new feature as a standalone code, meaning you know if you like classes, you do a new class with a public API. If you like Vicure Mage, you do a new Vicure Mage with a request. And if you like Actor Framework, you create a new Actor. Whatever is it that you understand as I'm giving you a set of functions, implementing everything that you want me to do, and then just place these VIs where you want the feature. Or you go into their code and implement the new feature in their spaghetti code. So, and that means finding out maybe they want an like, you know, right now, if they press a button, thing starts analyzing, and they want now just the color of the graph to change. So you say, well, I'll just go into where the graph is, and I'll change it there. All right? What's the third option?
Run away.
Run away. That will be the blue one. So what do you want to go? If you want to take the challenge, go ahead.
Does the first option also solve the problem?
Yes. So pink or green? New models and features will be released over time. So you are right now just working with the first model that they're putting in the market. You are in charge of the first testing application, okay? So where do you focus your time? Do you determine, build and deployment process, and try to do incremental deployments, starting with the proof of concept, or you get the code to work first, test internally, and you deploy the first release cabinet? And I can answer questions if there are any clarification questions. All right, no? Green or pink? You're not sure? What is it that is?
We have a separate hardware here.
Yeah, we have the actual first model. We do have, and we have two of them. One that doesn't work and one that works. And we have the complete test fixture here.
Can we deploy the code overseas?
Well, that's the thing. We don't know, right? So the question here is, do you figure that out to the beginning and then go to code? Or do you code and make the system work, and then when you're ready to deliver, you really you basically do the, acceptance process. And you wait until the acceptance process to do the release, the deployment.
The acceptance is done on their system, you won't need.
Start testing that. And it also gives you opportunity to
see some kind of like, no? Oh. Any questions?
It depends on the situation as well.
Depends on the situation?
You see success in horror stories. But that seems not most of it.
So, yes, that you can be success stories on the green. The success stories on the green that I work on are normally very, like what Becky was defined, very well-defined requirements. Everything is on contract, was signed, all the parts agreed. You go on, code, and then come back and do acceptance test and deliver the entire thing. And that can work. Now, I see more, and maybe it's because I work with teams that are in that process of growing up, right? Of figuring out that we're not just doing little BIs, we're actually doing software engineering and we need to figure out how to do this better. So it might be that that's why, that's my experience. But I've seen that the fastest I show the customer what they don't want, the fastest they're gonna tell me what they actually want. The fastest I give them what they don't need, the fastest we find what they actually need. And when you spend tons of time doing requirements and having all the reviews and everything, which totally makes sense if you're gonna be spending $100,000 for a test run, totally makes sense. But some of the smaller applications, does it really make sense to spend all this time when they don't even know exactly what they need? Okay? And that goes back to the contractor versus consultant. Am I there just to produce a test system, or am I there to help them figure out how to produce their own test system so I'm not cold every time they have a test system? And that's another thing. We do have a lot of returning business, but we don't want to make our customers spend. We like to come in for the phone bar and then I don't know if we're taking the rest. If they hire us to do the coding, we will do it.
Yeah, I would add that with some customers, remote deployment might be a huge risk if you don't address it at the beginning.
Yeah, there's the other thing. What if you're relying, so the case in New Zealand, right? We were relying on doing the same deployment that we have always used. Yeah, but those guys share an ESL line with Australia. I don't know if I'm right or not, but it's like the communication in New Zealand, the internet connection. Oh my God. I think the rotary dial that I had when I was a kid was up. So downloading new drivers and stuff was really not a possibility because it was taking too many hours. So we had to go with the drivers that had and stuff. There was really no way around it. Right? Okay. Or maybe there was a way around it, but because we chose to test it at the very end, there was no way around it. Okay, production automation code. Now, this one, the LabVIEW team is working on the same type of projects for several years. So this is, we're talking about large company, several projects, very similar. Maybe this one has two robots, the other one has three robots, this one has a conveyor, that one doesn't have the conveyor, but it's pretty much the same thing every time. New projects and features used to take 2 weeks to implement. And it's easy, right? That's why the manager bought it, because he was all about productivity. But now, the new projects and features take months. So the customer is thinking that because you're a CLA, or have been using LabVIEW for years, should be able to still add features in 2 weeks, right? It's not really that there's something wrong on the process or the software, it's really that he thinks that the proficiency of the developers is what's the problem. So let's go hire the best we can find, and they're gonna be able to produce features in 2 weeks.
Yeah,
they might be able to write features, not the features they're asking for, yeah. So, how do you think you should proceed? Should you save a previous project with the new name and then start modifying that project to fit what you think is going to be the new standard? Or, but for that project, for the next solution you're working on, or do you take the existing project and try to remove everything that's specific for different projects and create a template? the product update? Yeah. And why is it that you have not done it?
Because it seemed easier at the time to just take the stuff away that you didn't need.
Yeah, so easier at the time. Now, here's the thing. You work for a larger organization, right? So the budget and value is different than when you're working a paid by the hour. You're going to be acting in different ways. And I understand that. But there are other things that you value. And what it sounds like is what you value is your time. And because cutting corners and removing code was saving you time, that's the way you've always done it. But what if I told you that actually taking a little bit longer this time is going to save you 10 hours, 20 hours, 30 hours in the future? My favorite example, I think I say it every night week, I have a customer who has a printer, and we have to run the entire line every time he changes the printer. Meaning, put water in vials, put the vials in the conveyor, make the conveyor run so we can get to the end and we can test the printer. I ask him every time he calls me with the same problem, look, already spent 15 hours the last 5 years. It's like track that, right? I'm going to spend another, yes, 1 hour, I'm going to get it up and running. But how many more times are you going to call me to fix the printer? And by the way, it's very expensive to have me fixing the printer, right? So it's that question is yes. And at that moment, the problem is at that moment, the value for him is no longer time. It's just, I just want to get these off my back. I don't want to deal with it. But the problem is that he has probably 50 things that he's dealing with that. Because he's remaining. The thing that has been changing his approach is that the projects that we have worked together with, he rarely has to call me. And when the internal customers call him, he knows how to do the maintenance for the project. So he's starting to see those two projects, I budget maintenance time for them, and I have not used them. And I'm still doing all this. So now he's doing the work of convincing his boss with two projects that he can actually show him that it actually makes sense to make investment on having a template. So I guess I already asked why, which one I prefer. any other questions, comments? All right, so the last one is the refactor an existing application. Applications started using LabVIEW 4, I think, maybe. Features added with each new release of LabVIEW. Now, one really nice thing about this is the application always uses the latest version of LabVIEW. So we know we don't have to go and migrate code. They have been always updating the latest version of LabVIEW. The application, and again, this is a composite of several customers. The application mainly consists of two large VIs of the type. So when I use quotes in the VI, I mean like, blog diagram. The end users are non-technical, and the last couple of versions are pushing the limits of performance for even the highest MVCs. Okay? So they not only have to do the software, but they actually have to say which computer to use, with how much RAM, etc. So, customer wants to move away from having a single developer to being able to use contractors. He's worried about intellectual property. Those are the main two things. So the options. P, you start modularizing existing code and keep most of the code as is, and then you start refactoring one module at a time. This is, again, doing the meatballs approach on the spaghetti code. Or you start from scratch. You write your requirement, you define your modules, and you start writing one module at a time.
All
right.
Is there a time restraint?
What was that?
Is there a time restraint, or are we okay on time?
Well, it would be nice to get to market soon, right? Yeah, so there were a couple of things. This is something that Stephen Lopez Mercer was in the presentation at the CI Summit. He said, even though we would love to do the green one, right, start from scratch, that only works if you have two teams. You leave one team working with the old project and keep maintaining it, because you're still going to have to be doing bugs and bug fixes and everything. And then you have a new team working on the site from scratch. Because if you have the same team that is currently doing the application, the current application also working on the new application, there's going to be a time where you're going to have to let one go.
Well, to do the green one, you have to figure out what the original code's doing. In order to do that, you have to refactor.
Exactly.
Already refactoring it, that's like, oh.
Exactly. So one of the ways around it is you keep with the old product, the old project, right? And start identifying what are the sections of the code that I can start making two separate. Basically, start the surgery process of the code. The advantage of that is you're still releasing code, and you are improving your code as you go. It's going to take a lot longer, maybe. Probably you will never know. I mean, at this point, they have already been in the market for 10, 15 years. They have faster computers. They have more memory. Memory is cheaper. They are running in like super horse machines compared to where they started, and they're still having the problem. So it is a foundation of the code.
Yeah, the thing is that the architecture could be four.
Yeah, there's no architecture when you have two EIs. So you have to start by figuring out what are the modules, and then identify the sections of code again on that on the code and start making them into sub-EIs. If you're going to change the architecture, you can still grab those sub-EIs that now you have made into nice new code and put them in the new clean code, and with time start making them be the new one.
Which you probably can have through simple way.
Yeah, and that goes to what to Brian Powell's presentation. You need to be a homo programmer and you need to be willing to throw your code away. And that's, I think that is a big thing. You need to be able to sign that contract, right? That we are not going to go straight from spaghetti code to completely clean code and be able to keep all the intermediate versions we're doing. You're going to have to go, and you're going to have to go into mixed versions. Anyway, we're really running out of time, so one last thing I want you to think about. Conway's law, organizations with which design systems are constrained to produce designs which are copies of the communication structures of their organizations. And this is very similar to what Brian Powell said, right? If you don't have a certain personality, you're not going to be able to write code, or your code is going to be a reflection of your person. What does this mean? When you're thinking about technical law, it's not just creating new libraries and creating new code. Is what is it that is causing my team to make the decisions of not doing it? It is easy to do the right thing, but it's also very easy not to do it. What is it that my team values? Is it time? Is it not pulling your hair? Is it I don't want to scream to the guy that is, you know, messing around? Figure out what your team values. So for an example, I recommend going to desired paths for a simple software process. I think that's your presentation, right, Steve? And the nice thing about Steve Watt's presentation is he's going to show you all the processes that they do. And they were certified ISO 9000, right? People think that your processes need to be complex to be certified. And he will show you that you can have a pretty common sense approach and what he did for that. All right, Brian Powell already talked about code intent, and this is a typical situation, right? The commit notes just say minor block diagram changes. So this guy is like, commit. Who wrote that simple commit messages? What other files were touched? The code worked before then. Who did this? Oh, who was it? All right, so code, there's different ways to transmit code intent. Yes, there's the three labels on the block diagram of the DI, but there's also your commit notes, and there's also the unit tests. Code that runs doesn't mind, but it cannot describe the intent. So the way to describe intent would be with unit tests, because like Brian said, you have your inputs, you have your outputs, you know what the intention was, and also seeing how the developer used the API will tell you, will serve as an example of what was their thinking when they did the unit test, or how that
API needed to be used. So now you have an example that is actually useful, right? How many people here do unit tests? All right, so summarizing, just based on some of the things that we saw, these are examples of areas that you can do technical assets. I'm not expecting you to do all of them. Pick one, and then from that one, pick just a small part. All right, so don't try to do anything. Automate your test build deploy process. We use VLT because that has cut down the deploy process, and like I said, it has helped us a lot with deployments. Including this process, automated unit testing, running BI Analyzer. Having BI Analyzer has worked really well because when we have new people on board on the team, we can give them, yes, here are the 50 pages of our stock guidelines, but there's also the set of BI Analyzer custom tests that are available for BI Analyzer tests. If you run these on your code, you're going to be sure that Fabiola is not going to be yelling at you on code reviews. Because let's call them the Fabiola pacifiers, right? So there's an example of a test of a BI Analyzer test for Fabiola pacifier is Delacroix. We name our controls dash dash eno dash dash cluster dash dash ring, right? The reason for that is when you're using QuickDrop, you just do control space and you do dash dash eno and you get the list of all the enums you have in that project. So that's why we do it that way. What's the risk? What's the risk of naming something dash dash cluster dash dash enum? What happens if I decide and instead of an enum I actually have a ring? Right? So we have a BI Analyzer test that will ding you if you have a CTL that doesn't have the dash dash something, and it will ding you if what you say you have is not what you have inside. Okay. Treat technical assets as a customer. Treat your internal tools, frameworks, reusable code as a customer project. And that's about the same thing that Becky says. Review how much time you're investing every month on your technical wealth. Keep an asset on how much you're actually accruing. Understand the return of investment. If you are realizing that you're saving 10 hours every time, put it somewhere. And again, determine what your team values. And value does not mean money necessarily. It could just be, I don't want to yell at you. Track areas for improvement. When using your internal tools, immediately log areas for improvement. Review open issues at the same time that you review customer open issues. Like again, treat your internal projects as a customer. You would not stop writing code for a customer. When working on code, immediately log ideas for new internal tools. Weekly meetings, any way that you can do retrospectives for analyzing what we could have had that would have prevented us from getting to this situation in the first place, right? And then spend time on that. And if you have seen VQMage, you'll see that a lot of the things that you see in VQMage are this thing. This is why VQMage has testers. This is why VQMage pushes you to do testing. Because we found that the sooner you test, better for you. Assign a value to technical assets, I already told you that. And make sure, I needed to put a hand there. My first mentor when I started working told me once, it's not only enough to lay the eggs, you have to make sure you sing so the farmer knows that it was you and not someone else. But this is, if you're having trouble to convince your organization on doing something, find out what is it that those people value and then put in those terms why spending time on these things is going to save them time, pulling hers, whatever. And yes, I used to say, program as if you were programming for a psychopath that knows where you live. Now I say, be nice to future you. So it depends if you like me, weep and be scared to them. It's the first one. I find that I think this is much better. And like Norm was saying earlier, just think on how you can help the rest of the people that are going to come to the code. All right, guys. I talked about the return on investments. Don't think that you're going to be doing this. Just start with a little thing. And the main thing is, what is the return on investment? You're going to be able to react with confidence to changes in scope, deadlines, and resources. The day you find that you're not having to stay after hours to work on a bug because it turned out that you had the test and you immediately found the solution, that's when you have arrived and you'll see the return on investment.
Okay, so we're not going to do this unless you want to do it. If there's something that you thought right now that you wanted to do, as I'm going to go back to my desk, and this is what I'm going to create as a technical asset. If you want to share that with me, that would be great.